Good morning. My name is Cindy Bright. I'm the pastor to youth and families. And on behalf of your other pastors and church staff, it is my pleasure to welcome you to worship here at Russellville First United Methodist Church this morning. At this congregation, we seek to make disciples who love God and love others. And we're so glad that you've joined us for worship today. If you're a guest with us, either in person or online, we want you to know that we are especially glad that you are here, and we hope that you find a way to feel at home, that we can make you feel comfortable as part of this church family. One way to do that is to get involved in the things that are going on in the life of the church. So I encourage you to turn to the back of your bulletin or in your online bulletin to the News to Use page. You will see a lot of information there about what's going on in the life of the church. We have poinsettias again this Christmas. There's information there about how to sign up for those. If you're in person, there's an insert in your bulletin, but that's also available on our church website. We have lessons and carols coming up two Sundays from now on December 13th. We encourage you to register online if you want to come in person and be a part of that service. And there's information there as well. If you want to be a part of that service from home, we have a way for you to have candles and be a part of that service. So I hope you will take time to look at all of the other announcements, find your way to get plugged into the life of the church. We again are so thankful that you're here to worship with us. Let's enter into worship with our prelude. I invite you to stand as you're able for the reading of the call to worship. Would you join me? Advent is a time of waiting, a time to open our hearts to God's presence, a time to pay attention to God's call. God's love breaks in over and over again. Be awake, for God is near. You may be seated. I'd like to invite the Lensing family to come and lead us in the lighting of our Advent candles.
A reading from Ephesians 4. Conduct yourselves with all humility, gentleness, and patience. Accept each other with love and make an effort to preserve the unity of the Spirit with the peace that ties you together. You are one body and one Spirit, just as God also called you in one hope.
We light this candle to signify our hope for the Prince of Peace, whose birth we await in this Advent season, who brings peace, not as the world gives, but true peace that passes all understanding. Let us pray. Lord God, we look to you to bring us true peace in a world where peace seems far away. We hear your call to us to be peacemakers, within ourselves and in the world around us. But we know we cannot find peace apart from your grace. Prince of Peace, we wait for you. Come, Lord Jesus, be born in our midst. Grant us peace in our hearts and lives. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. Would you please join me in the opening prayer? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Ever-present God, you taught us that the night is far spent and the day is at hand. Grant that we may ever be found watching for the coming of your Son. Save us from undue love of the world, that we may wait with patient hope for the day of the Lord, and so abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may not be ashamed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from the 13th chapter of Mark, verses 24 through 37. Would you please stand as you're able for the reading of God's holy word? At that time, after the anguish of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will give no light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then everyone will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out his angels to gather his chosen ones from all over the world, from the farthest ends of the earth and heaven. Now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its branches bud and its leaves begin to sprout, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see all these things taking place, you can know that his return is very near. Right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will not pass from the scene before all these things take place. Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will never disappear. However, no one knows the day or hour when these things will happen, not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. And since you don't know when that time will come, be on guard. Stay alert. The coming of the Son of Man can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. When he left home, he gave each of his slaves instructions about the work they were to do, and he told the gatekeeper to watch for his return. You too must keep watch, for you don't know when the master of the household will return, in the evening, at midnight, before dawn, or at daybreak. Don't let him find you sleeping when he arrives without warning. I say to you what I say to everyone, watch for him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. I love movies. In case you didn't know that, you do know that now. Movie gift cards are always a good option. But let me tell you that COVID has really put a damper on my movie going and movie watching ability. And I'm very excited to be able to head back to the cinema in coming months and watch a movie at the movie theater. I like to do that. When Michael and I first got married, we were poor. We were really, really poor. We were juniors in college. We had no money. It was pretty bad. And our only entertainment would have been free TV, but we lived in this, literally, it was a shack with a tin roof, and that means we got one channel on only a very clear night. We lived out in the country. It was pretty rough. And so our entertainment once a week was we went to the Walmart in town and got in the $3 bin and got a movie. I don't even know if they have the $3 bin anymore. Maybe they do. It's probably $5 now, but you know, it's the B movies in the bin, and we would pick out a movie. And this created quite a collection of VHSs and DVDs. At one point, we had over 300 movies and DVDs. Those days are gone. We don't have that money anymore. Digital and streaming has come along. And so now we only have 184. Only. But they're all digital as well, not to mention all the streaming services we have. And then later on, when we moved to London and we weren't so poor anymore, there was this really cool thing at our cinema. It was called Cineworld Unlimited. And for about $45 a month for both of us, we could watch all the movies we wanted anytime we wanted. It was awesome. It was really a great thing for us. And so we did do that on our day off. You know, we're both pastors, and so our day off was the same. And when Melissa was in school, and they have year-round school, so we did this a lot, we would go to the town north of us, to our Cineworld, and we would watch a double feature, sometimes a triple feature in a day. We really like movies, and that's something that we've done. So hopefully you got the pictures. I like movies. Yeah? Well, you might surprise you that liking movies has really helped me read the Bible. When I read scripture, I picture it in my head. It's a moving picture in my head when I read the Bible. Maybe some of you are shaking your head, so you do that as well in your head. What happens is I can see these stories play out in my mind's eye. And so this new sermon series, coming soon, is totally up my alley with my love of scripture and my love of movies. And so the flow of the Advent season that we're entering is like a movie. Really, it is, I promise you. Today we get a hint of this Christmas story as we're invited to stay tuned for what is to come. And then next week, through the life and ministry of John the Baptist and the scene and the life of Jesus Christ gets set up, and we are drawn to remember our baptism and our wilderness experiences. And then the suspense is going to heighten the next week as we end up in the middle of Advent season, and we witness through Elizabeth and Mary that nothing is impossible with God. And it all builds up to our final week of Advent, the climax of the Christmas story, when the Christ child is born, but born not in a way we would probably expect. The plot twist, it ends in a cliffhanger that invites us to wonder, how are we called to participate in this story? And so I promise you, you're not going to want to miss a week of this epic movie through the scriptures as we move towards Christmas. Today is the first day of Advent. I know you figured it out. We've said it. We've lit candles. You've got it. But I want to be clear that it is the first Sunday of Advent, which means we have entered a new church year. Happy New Year, church. Thank you. And so as we enter this new church year, we also enter this season of a journey through this story that is crazy familiar to all of us, right? And it really can be like a favorite movie to us, right? A movie that you've seen over and over again. I don't know about you, but I have a few of those that I can pretty much quote line for line. Some of you are shaking your head. Some of you like movies like I like movies. But you know this story. You know what comes next. You can recite the lines. You know when there's a funny scene getting ready to happen that might make you chuckle. You might cringe in the knowledge of what's to come a little bit later. You might even tear up when you hear the story. I know that the story of Jesus' birth can have all those moments for me. That is, if I let it sink in and I don't just read over it because I know it so very well. So as we come to this really familiar story, the story of the birth of Christ, I'd like you to think of our scripture today that Pastor Cindy read to us as the movie trailer, okay? So imagine with me, if you will, for a minute. Now, I don't have the right voice for this, so just imagine, okay? Imagine a deep, booming voiceover, okay? And it sets the scene. In those days, after the suffering of that time, the sun will become dark and the moon won't give its light. And the camera pans over to that fig tree that's beginning to sprout branches and leaves and shoots. And the voiceover continues, but nobody knows when that day or hour will come, not the angels in heaven, and not the Son, only the Father knows. And the trailer ends with a, watch out, stay alert. That trailer paints this really familiar story we have of cute sheep and wise men with gifts and singing angels and curious shepherds with a more suspenseful, action-filled, ominous plot entitled Advent Apocalypse. When we read the Christmas story that way, it's a far different cry from the G-rated version that we tell our children, or even that we tell ourselves. So let me ask you, if you and I were to read it this way, how might that affect the way you enter into Advent this year? A season that is known for expectation and preparation and waiting. Are we merely just waiting for baby Jesus to be born? Or are we waiting for something more? That short parable about the fig tree and the illustration of the slaves and the owners that is in our scripture reading, they weren't concerned so much about what we're waiting for, but more concerned about illuminating how we are waiting. Nowhere does that trailer reveal the date of the movie that's coming. It can arrive at any time, so constantly be checking your movie listening. Stay tuned. There is a sense of urgency because what that parable and that illustration describe is not an event that occurs in the far-off future. It is here. It is now. So unlike what we teach our children, there is no time for patience or complacency. On the contrary, we, as Christians, are to be waiting impatiently. Jesus is saying, keep alert, be aware, stay awake and pay attention. Look for God all around us and live in God's present reign that is shown wherever love changes hearts, redeems brokenness, and saves lives. What would it look like if we lived our lives alert, not missing out on the beauty and the miracles before us? Not denying the way that Jesus speaks to us and calls us. How can we be constantly on the lookout for places that desperately call us to make known God's forgiveness and his generosity, his justice, his abundance, and his love? What if we entered this Advent season alert, in the fields like the shepherds, ready to receive the angels' messages that the time has come? Or like the Magi who were consistently watching until they spotted that star that would guide them to what they had been looking for. This imagery in our scripture of staying awake today made me look into the science of sleep a little bit, and my mom has insomnia, so both of those two things kind of coincided this week a little bit. So stay with me here as I connect the Bible and our scripture to sleep science. So before I get there, let me say, I think one of our dangers as Christians is not the big dramatic rejection of God and our faith or our refusal to step up and do the right things at the right times. I don't think that's our biggest danger. My educated guess is our biggest danger is being lulled to sleep. That's our greatest danger. Lulled to sleep away from the voice of God and God's presence and power in our lives and its coming fullness. So here's the science stuff. Neuroscience speak of the stages of sleep. And it begins when our brains begin to disengage from the external world. And next, the brain shifts to this, like, in-between stage that generally, when a person is awoken from this stage, they do not categorize that as sleep. You know what stage I'm talking about, right? It happens to me in my chair when I watch TV. Someone elbows you and says, wake up. You're like, I'm not asleep, right? You know what I'm talking about? It happens to us. We are not conscious of when we enter the state of sleep. The process of sleep in those first two stages make it impossible for us to define exactly when we fell asleep. Falling asleep is more accurately described as sliding into sleep. And I think that speaks to our text today. We can so easily slide into no longer being alert, being tuned in. Not just to the story of Christ's birth, but to that whole kit and caboodle of faith. So let me encourage you, as you begin this new church year, as you walk into this Advent season, to tune in, to check your sleep pattern. Are you sliding into sleep when it comes to your faith journey? When it comes to your path of discipleship? When it comes to what God has named you, claimed you, and called you for, you were created for so much more. Don't miss out on it because you're sliding into sleep. Stay tuned. Stay alert. Because the story, the whole story, that we think that we know so, so, so very well, it might have some twist that we didn't expect. Amen.
As we respond to God's word with the time of prayer, I encourage you to look at the names of those we have on our prayer list in the bulletin. And we know that we want to add also to the list of condolences the family of Kay Green. Let's turn to God in a time of prayer. Loving and gracious God, you stand at the door of our hearts, knocking and seeking entrance. Your desire is to enter into our hearts, living in relationship with us, so much so that you come in the form of a tiny baby, stripped of all the riches of heaven. Help us to strip away all the trappings of this life that might get in the way of that relationship. Let us not get so wrapped up in cares and concerns or even the pleasures of this world that we be caught unaware of just how close you have drawn to us. Let us not be so busy with all that's going on that we, like the innkeeper, say that we have no room and relegate you to a distance. Help us to use this time of Advent to prepare our hearts as a place for you. May the lights, the decorations, the music, and all of our worship point us back to you. You are the answer and comfort to all the pain, the struggle, injustice, and illness, the grief and the fear we experience. You've encouraged us to cast our cares on you, so we bring you all of our concerns, including those on our prayer list today. We pray for Carol, for Julia, for Whitney and Randy and the Atkins family, for Amy, for Ray, for Ward, and for the families of Harold, Ron, and Kay. Your word tells us that before we call, you will answer, and while we are still speaking, you will hear. So we thank you for hearing us, God. We thank you for answering, and we ask for healing, for peace, for grace, comfort, hope, love, and joy, all of the promises of Advent. We bring you all of these prayers and praises in the matchless name of the one who comes, Jesus Christ. And we pray together the prayer he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Another way we respond to God's word is by giving of our tithes and our offerings. And so as we come to that time today, I want to remind you that if you are here with us in person, you have a little insert that tells you today is United Methodist Student Day. And we're taking donations for that. It helps fund scholarships for students all over the world so that they can further their education and enrich the life of the church. So we encourage you to give as you're being led to do that. And we also want to remind you that year-end giving contributes a significant part of our budget. And so if you are being led to give in that way too, we would love for you to do that as we receive God's tithes and our offerings. And you can see this is one of the ways that your giving supports the kingdom of God. And these are children, I think, in our TLC ministry. It's a blessing several days a week to hear the little voices and the running feet as our teachers care for these beautiful children of God. And so we thank you for the ways that you give to support this ministry and so many others. We have a number of ways that you can give. We want to make that as easy for you as possible. So you can see there on your screen, you can call, you can text, you can click on the website, you can mail a check, or you can use a simple give app. There's lots and lots of ways to give. If you're here in person, we do have offering plates that you'll find on the tables on your way out of the service, and we encourage you to leave your gifts there as well. So let's ask God to bless what we're about to give. Almighty God, if you had only given us Jesus, it would have been enough. But you are a generous God, and you have given us far, far more than that. So we pray that you will help us to be good stewards of all that you have given. We pray that you will help us be cheerful and joyful givers as a return, a portion of that to you. We ask that you would take our tithes and our offerings and use them to grow your kingdom. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
As you consider other ways to respond to God, I want to invite you to participate in the Advent devotional. I left it in the sacristy. I would have brought it. It's a little blue book called Almost Christmas. I checked this morning. If you have Amazon Prime, it will still arrive in time because it starts on December 1st. You can get it from other retailers as well. But I invite you to join with your church and focus this Advent season in looking at those questions and little short devotionals every day. I think it will really encourage you in your faith and challenge you in your walk with Christ this Advent season. And of course, if you're thinking about membership or baptism, please contact Pastor Tony or myself. And remember that your pastors and your congregational care ministers are available for you should you need someone to meet with you and pray with you or talk through things happening in life. Know that you are loved and that you are cared for. Let's sing our closing hymn. Thank you so much for joining us in person or virtually, digitally, not virtually, for worship today. We are glad that we were able to celebrate this first Sunday of Advent with you. As you go and journey into this Advent season, remember, there is hope, there is peace, there is love, and there is joy. Those are those things we remember with our Advent candle this year. But also remember that this is an epic story. One that can surprise us if we allow it to surprise us. Remember that Jesus calls us to stay alert, stay awake, to stay tuned. Don't slide into sleep when it comes to your faith. Receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and give you peace this day and every day.
Friends, if you are here joining us in person, I want to remind you during our benediction, if you would please just hold hands with those who are in your household. And then if you would be seated, you can enjoy a beautiful postlude as our ushers will come and dismiss you row by row. We are so glad that you've been here with us, however you've joined us today. So I would encourage you to stay alert, pay attention to how God is drawing near to you and how God is calling you to make a difference in the world. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord.